So far, before your mid-semester, we have discussed about single-stage amplifiers. We discussed how to build amplifiers using a single MOS device or a bipolar junction transistor device. And I stress this point again and again, is that the device has changed. We have moved from a vacuum tube transistors to a bipolar junction transistor, and then we have moved to MOSFETs today. Now, I'll very briefly discuss about our motivations for moving from device to device. But you can see here, what I've shown here, the first one is a common cathode configuration. In a vacuum tube amplifier, there were three terminals, anode, cathode, and grid terminal. I told you guys in the beginning itself, most amplifiers operate on a very simple principle. So they'll have two terminals between which a current normally flows between two terminals, and a third terminal can control the flow of current between the two other terminals, which in this example, in case of a vacuum tube amplifier, the gate or the grid terminal happens to be the controlling terminal, and the current flows between anode and cathode. So you have one terminal which generates electrons, other terminal which collects it, and the third terminal which can control the flow of current between this emitting terminal and a collecting terminal. So I've just put it in very simple words. All the three devices, whether it's a vacuum tube amplifier, a bipolar junction transistor amplifier, or a MOS amplifier, they all behave, the fundamental principle is that. Of course, the physics behind that will vary. It varies from device to device. Okay, so a BJT is more of a diffusion-based device of minority carrier diffusion. That's what is causes current in a BJT. A MOSFET is a drift-based device, majority carriers drift in its inverted region. And a vacuum tube amplifier operates on thermionic emission. Okay, so the physics of operation is different for all the devices, but fundamentally they all try to control the flow of current between two terminals by an application of voltage on the third terminal. And I've shown here a standard amplifier configuration in all the three devices. First one is what we call common cathode amplifiers. I told you guys a vacuum tube amplifier was invented early 1900s, 1908, 7, around that time. From the time it was invented for nearly four decades till 1910, 20, 30, and 40, vacuum tube amplifiers completely ruled in almost all the electronic devices. So two wars were waged, companies were building telephones, and there were new companies which were springing up at that time. The companies, major companies which were building these devices were there's something called Westinghouse. And again, if you have studied basic circuit theory, which is your basic electrical sciences, you would know the war between Westinghouse and Edison in late 1800s. After that, we had this new age of radio and telephone in early 1900s. So at that time, we needed devices which could amplify very weak signals. So that's when this invention of amplifiers started, or the work on this amplifier started. So in 1908, the first amplifier was invented, which was a vacuum tube amplifier. And after that, nearly four decades, the amplifiers were perfected. So invention is just one part of the whole the field. In any field, invention is just the beginning. This is just the tip of the iceberg. It usually takes many decades and years of fine-tuning to make it as a proper product. And it took nearly four decades of using vacuum tube amplifiers. In 1947 to be precise, as in India, we just won our independence. Around the same time, on the other side of the world, there were three scientists who invented a point contact transistor. And Barton, Braden, and Shockley. And from the point contact transistor, a year later, a new transistor called a bipolar or a junction transistor emerged. And the whole 1950s were using these junction transistors, bipolar junction transistors. And in 1960, an invention, an idea which was put on the back burner was taken again. And a new device called MOSFET, which is a field effect device, was invented in late 1950s or around 1960. This device was invented. Now, the thing is that whenever we move from device to device, of course, all three are amplifying devices, but today we will hardly see vacuum tubes at all. We'll never see vacuum tubes today. Okay, they're more on the antique pieces, but they're hardly seen in today's applications. We will normally see MOSFETs in most of the applications today. And I already told you, you count the total number of MOSFETs ever manufactured, they will outnumber every other man-made invention. Okay, they will outnumber every other man-made invention. You count the total number of matchsticks ever made by man, they will still outnumber the total number of MOSFETs made will outnumber the number of matchsticks ever made, or the number of wheels that are ever made. Now, the first thing is that we switched from vacuum tubes to BJTs because it looked like the best thing to do at that time. Because vacuum tubes, the fundamental principle of operation required heating a coil, and that because you were heating a coil like an electric bulb, they operated very similar to the idea for vacuum tube came from the ideas of electric bulb and all that. So it operates on the principle of heating a coil. You needed separate a lot of power to be burnt in heating a coil. So it was bulky, extremely, extremely high in power consumption. So BJT came as a welcome shift. Power consumption was reduced significantly. The devices could be made very compact. So it was a welcome shift from vacuum tubes to BJTs. But then the shift from BJT to MOSFET is not a shift driven by analog engineers. So when vacuum tube was there in 1940s, it was also used in computers. Okay, the shift for vacuum tubes to BJTs was a welcome shift for analog engineers because it was simple, power saving and all of that. But the shift from BJT to MOSFET is not entirely a shift for an analog engineer's convenience. It's more of a digital engineer's convenience. MOSFETs famously have, by now you know that the gate current is zero for MOSFET. So therefore, when you build digital circuits using MOSFETs, they tend to have zero static power dissipation. I mean, there is something called CMOS technology. Most of you probably will be learning very soon. A complementary MOS technology, which has zero static power dissipation. Therefore, we moved to that. And also, we could pack a lot more transistors. The packing density of MOSFETs was extremely higher compared to BJTs. But purely from a device-to-device point of view, if I'm comparing BJT versus MOSFET, a BJT always has a higher transconductance. So why does a BJT have a higher transconductance for a given current? We answer this question. Why does a BJT have higher transconductance for a given current? Can you say that from looking at the transfer characteristics? See, whenever I ask transconductance, think
sir, about transfer exponential behavior.
Yes,
for transfer.
So, yes, a bipolar junction transistor is an exponential device. The transfer characteristics are exponential. So if you draw the voltage versus current characteristics, whereas a MOSFET is a square law device. An exponential device will always have a greater slope. The slope of this is actually transconductance. The slope of this graph is a transconductance. So therefore, BJT is a superior device. It gives you higher transconductance for the same bias current. So that's the advantage of a bipolar junction transistor. And also we will see that they will be faster compared to MOSFETs. But the reason why we switched to MOSFETs is two major reasons. Zero static power dissipation. BJTs consume a finite base current. So for them, when you're using these circuits, when you build digital logic circuits using BJTs and MOSFETs, the circuits built using MOSFETs, complementary MOSFETs, will have zero static power dissipation. When the logic levels are not changing, a BJT circuit will still be drawing power, whereas a MOS circuit will not draw any power. That's why we switched from BJT to MOSFET. And we know the world is moving towards digital. We are sticking to analog where you cannot get away with analog. Okay, so but everything is getting digitized. So we are bringing a lot of digital ideas even to analog today. So that's the shift. The reason for shift is not from an analog engineer's point of view, but from the convenience of a digital design. Now the next question is, we have just discussed single stage amplifiers. We haven't yet discussed a very important thing called frequency response. Okay, and we will talk in much greater detail about frequency response in the upcoming lectures, probably in the week after that. But now I'll just introduce you very briefly to what is that problem, because I have to explain a different amplifier topology. To understand that, you should first understand what frequency response is. So far, when we designed an amplifier, we saw how to calculate the gain of an amplifier. Okay, we saw how to calculate the gain of an amplifier. So as an engineer, you know input signal level, then you know what is the desired output signal level. Then from that, you estimate what the gain is. And when you design the gain, the gain has a non-discriminatory behavior, meaning it doesn't discriminate what frequency of sine wave you are applying. I've shown here this is a very low frequency sine wave. Okay, a low frequency sine wave, when you pass it through an amplifier, you are going to get an amplified version. That's why we are using amplifiers for. Will this amplifier give me same amplification if I use a high frequency sine wave? Okay, the study of this amplifiers as a function of the input frequency, as a function of the frequency of the input signal, it's called frequency response. You will see how the amplifier is going to behave as I vary the frequency of my input signal. Is it going to give me the same gain, or the gain is going to reduce or increase as frequency increases? Now, to answer that for each and every topology, we will do a proper mathematical analysis much later, probably after we finish differential pairs. But right now, I just introduced the idea that it will not be the case. Most devices we use, BJTs, MOSFETs, vacuum tube amplifiers, they come with parasitic capacitances. And the problem with the parasitic capacitance is that, let me show a simple example. If I have a parasitic capacitor, let's say you have a resistor and capacitor here. This happens to be an unwanted parasitic capacitor. Then what can you say about the impedance of a capacitor? So from your basic electrical sciences, the impedance of a capacitance is 1 by omega C, right? So as you increase the frequency of your signal, what do you think is happening to the impedance of a capacitance? As you increase the frequency, what happens to the impedance of your capacitance? It decreases. Do you see that from this equation, the impedance of a capacitance is given by 1 by omega C. As you increase omega, which is frequency, it behaves, its impedance starts decreasing. What is the fundamental operation of a MOS device? We had a current GMVI, we generate a current GMVI proportional to the, a current proportional to the input voltage, and push this current into an impedance like this. So if there was no capacitance, then the voltage gain would always have been minus GMR. But now, if there is a capacitance here, what do you think will happen to the voltage gain? What is happening to the impedance here? Can I say the voltage gain will be minus of GM into Z of omega? Instead of GM into R, I'll replace R with some complex impedance Z. As you increase frequency, the impedance of the capacitance is decreasing, which means Z of omega is decreasing. If Z of omega is decreasing, what do you expect the gain to be? Can I say the gain also decreases as frequency increases? Is that okay? So I'm saying that generally most of these devices, MOS devices, BJT, or these vacuum tube amplifiers, they all come with parasitic capacitors. We will analyze in more detail about the source of these parasitic capacitors when we introduce frequency response. But now I'm just showing you a problem. If you had a capacitance at the output node, all I'm saying is that if you increase the frequency of the input signal, the gain will start reducing as a function of frequency. After some point, your gain will start decreasing. And that's because of this capacitive behavior. We don't want that. We want to design amplifiers to be able to amplify any signal. I don't have to worry about this frequency, or to amplify for a wide range of frequencies. Okay, so we want to design a wide band amplifier. So what I've shown here is a simple RC circuit. So since most of you have done basic control theory, you must have heard of the term time constant. So what does time constant represent? What is time constant? What is time constant represent? Basic control theory idea. What does it represent? Yeah, for the time taken for any system, yeah, I'm just asking the general way, can we talk about what a time constant is, a general definition of a time constant? It tells you approximately an idea about how fast a system will attain its steady state. Is that okay? For example, when a doctor uses a thermometer on you to measure the temperature, Usually the doctor waits for some time till he or she reads the final result. Because a thermometer has a finite time constant. It takes some time to settle down to the final correct temperature. Okay? So most systems, before it settles down, it takes some time. So usually a time constant is a value, it's a metric. It tells you how fast or how slow your system is, or what, or how slow does your system, or how fast and how slow your system is before it attains its steady state. Okay, so it gives you a rough idea about that. So here I've shown a simple RC circuit. For an RC circuit, what is the steady state voltage across the capacitor? In the circuit here, I'm applying a voltage, step voltage 0 to Vx. What will be the steady state voltage across the capacitor? See, in the steady state, you can always assume capacitance behaves like an open circuit. If capacitance behaves like an open circuit, then the current flowing is 0 through the resistor. So which means the voltage here will also be Vx. This voltage here will also be Vx. So which means the capacitance is eventually charged to a voltage of C times Vx. Where does this charge come from? Who is providing this charge? A capacitance is eventually charged to C into Vx. Where does this charge come from? It comes from this voltage source. The voltage source is providing that charge, right? The battery of the voltage source here is providing that charge. Now the resistance here, see, eventually the capacitance has to get a charge of C times Vx. But now the resistance here will dictate how fast this charge is transferred to the capacitor. Now let's say there was no resistance here. There was no resistance here and you just had a capacitance C here. What is the time for it to charge to, for a charge C times Vx to be transferred from the voltage source to the capacitance? Instantly, there's zero time, right? It takes no time, instantly the charge is transferred. But now you have a resistor. I can say that the charge transfer takes place slowly. There will be a time constant associated with it. The time constant is given by the product of R into C. Okay, we'll talk about this in more detail, the mathematics of it, once we go to frequency response. Now I'm just introducing you to this problem so that we can appreciate cascode amplifiers. So this is the time constant, right? It's that it tells you roughly how fast or how long does this system take to attain a steady state, or how long this capacitor takes to be charged to a voltage of C times Vx. Vx, or to charge of C times Vx, is transferred from voltage to the capacitance. What happens if this capacitance increases? If the capacitance increases, what happens to the time constant? Time constant, it will take much longer to settle. It will take much longer to settle. So I'm going to call this a slower system. If your time constant is large, I'm going to call it as a slower system. The system is going to be slow. Okay? The system is going to be slow. So it's taking very slowly to respond to the input. Okay, it's taking a really long time to respond to the input. So as your capacitance increases, keeps increasing, the time constant also keeps increasing, which means your system is becoming slower and slower and slower. So large capacitance automatically means a slower system. So now, if I'll give you two cases. One case, you assume that your capacitance is C. The other case, the capacitance is 100 C. And now I'm going to apply a sine wave, say a frequency, a very large frequency, and I'm going to look at the output at this point. In which case, whether case of C or 100 C, do you think the amplitude will be lower? The sine wave's amplitude will be lower at the output? So first of all, what does large C means? Large C means that it's going to take a much longer time to charge the capacitor, right? The product of RC will be large, which means it's going to take large time to charge the capacitor. If I'm going to apply a very high frequency sine wave at the input, of course the input is trying to charge the capacitor, but before the capacitor is able to charge, the input becomes negative. Now the input is quickly trying to discharge it, but before it discharges fully, the input has become positive. So therefore, I can see that the amplitude will be attenuated. So now let's assume I apply a very, very slowly varying sine wave. very slowly varying sine wave. I'm giving sufficient time for the capacitor to charge. Then the voltage will more or less track. You will get an output as it is. It will look the same as the input. But if you apply a very high frequency sine wave, before your capacitor, it's slowly taking time to charge. But before it charges, the input becomes negative. So your output will be smaller. So now I'm giving you an example. R is same. I'm feeding the same sine wave to two RC circuits. One RC circuit has a capacitance of value C. The other RC circuit has a capacitance of value 100C. Now, which circuit do you think will give the output amplitude will be larger in which case? In the case of C or 100C? In which case the output amplitude sine, the amplitude of the output sine wave will be larger? In the case C, do you all agree? So there are two things that you realize here. In any system, if you minimize the capacitance, you will be able to amplify for a wider range of frequencies. Your systems become faster. So I'm going to use the word, if you reduce capacitance, time constant reduces, means your system is becoming fast. Slower time, a smaller time constant means system is fast. And you can amplify for a wide range of frequencies. So keep this point in mind. We'll now start with the problem of what exactly is the problem and how are we trying to solve it. Now first, let's start with a simple case here. This is a common, so is this point clear to everyone? So you have any doubts, you can ask me. Now I'll start discussing the actual topic. So smaller capacitance means smaller time constant. A smaller time constant means the system is faster, or it will be able to amplify for a wider range of frequencies. It will be able to amplify high frequency signals. Okay, so that's the point to keep in mind. Now let's start with a simple common source amplifier. I've introduced a capacitance between gate and drain. We'll see what is this capacitance, what is the source of the capacitance later. But right now, let's assume that there is some parasitic capacitance between gate and drain. Assume R naught is infinity, if I apply a voltage VI here, what will be your output voltage? Can you tell me in terms of VI? Ignore the capacitance, steady state voltage. What will be the steady state voltage in terms of VI? Small signal steady state voltage. RL is the load resistance. Assume GM is the input transconductance. R naught is infinity. What will be the value of VI? Let's assume the capacitance is open. Steady state capacitance is open. Minus GM RL times VI. Minus GM RL times VI is your output voltage. So eventually, you look at this capacitance. Look at this capacitance C. On one side, the capacitor voltage is VI. On the other side, the capacitance voltage is minus of GM RL into VI. So what is the total voltage across the capacitor? So you have a capacitor. On one side, it is charged to, it's a voltage VI. The other side, the voltage is minus of GM RL into VI. So what is the total voltage across the capacitor? 1 plus GM RL into VI. Is that right? So the total voltage across the capacitor is 1 plus GM RL into VI. So now if the total charge stored across this capacitor will be 1 plus GM RL into VI times C. This is the total charge that is stored across this capacitor. And where does that charge come from? That charge comes entirely from the input. Now let's assume an input has a source resistance. I already told you we have input source resistance because we model source resistance with a voltage source to capture the finite power delivering capacity. We already discussed that in the previous lectures. You can refer to that in case you have forgotten. But if you take a weak source, means a source that can deliver very low power, then RS will be very high. The value of RS will be very high for weak sources. Microphone is an example. Its source resistance will be very high because it can deliver power in the order of milliwatts or less than a milliwatt, few tenths of a milliwatt. So RS will be very high. Okay. Now, your capacitor has to be fully charged But what I'm interested in is the charging process. Eventually, the capacitor has to be charged to this voltage, 1 plus GM R0 into VI. I mean, see, one of you are asking, what do you mean by capacitance fully charged? What do you mean after that? After that, what happens to the circuit? The circuit has attained its steady state. At that point, your output voltage is minus of GM RL times VI. It has attained its steady state. That's what you want. Okay? But the problem is, it's not an instantaneous. The moment you apply VI here, the output voltage does not become minus GM RL into VI instantaneously. Because to charge this capacitor C, the charge has to come from the input. That is the only path, right? Gate current is zero here. The charge has to entirely come from the input and charge this capacitance. That's because your gate current is zero, so that there is no other path for the charge to come. Now look at this. You have a scenario where the input is going to think, because this capacitor is demanding a charge of value this, 1 plus GM RL into C, the input voltage is going to think that it is in fact charging a capacitor of value given by 1 plus GM RL into C. Okay? So now, if you see here, the input is going to think that it's supposed to send a charge, it's 1 plus GM RL into C. It's actually charging a capacitance of value 1 plus GM RL into C. Eventually, it's going to charge it to VA. So this is the charge it's going to transfer. It's going to transfer a charge of 1 plus GM RL into VA into C. So it's going to think that it's actually charging a really large capacitor. So this effect of seeing a multiplied capacitance at the input, it's called Miller effect. We will talk about this in much greater detail later. But right now, you can just appreciate the idea that if you have a capacitor which is supposed to be charged to a really large voltage across it, because it appears between two high gain points, okay? Because of that, it has to be charged to a very large voltage. And therefore, all the charge, because it has to come from the input, it's going to take a really long time. Because especially if your RS is very high, the time constant of the input is going to be very, very high. Okay? Your time constant at the input is going to be very high because RS is high. At the same time, it also has to transfer a large charge. So it's going to take a really long time, which means the system is slower or it may not amplify high frequency signals. So this is the problem with a conventional common source amplifier or a common cathode amplifier and vacuum tube amplifier. So this was a problem the engineers were solving at that time. Okay, so there was a parasitic capacitance between the input and the output terminal. Directly a parasitic capacitance between input and output terminal. In fact, it was slightly more involved as well. They had something called feedback from the input to the output through the capacitance. But anyways, this capacitance was creating the problem of speed. So did you understand what the problem is? Did you understand what the problem is here? The capacitance C is charged to a value which is 1 plus GM RL into VI. It's charged to a really large voltage, which means, and all the charge has to come from the input. There is no other path for it. So the capacitance seen by the input, at the input, even though the C can be a very small capacitance, at the input, it looks like a really large capacitance because the input is supplying a really large charge. So therefore, it's going to think it's a really large capacitance. But in reality, it's a small capacitance which is charged to a really large voltage. And the problem is not because it is supposed to be charged to a really large voltage, okay? But because the charge has to come from the input, that's the problem. Okay, because your charge has to come from the input, it has to come through the source resistance, which is going to delay it, which is going to make it slower. Okay, so this is the problem right now. So how do we fix it? So the natural fix for this, the engineers at that time, so the problem occurred in vacuum tube amplifier. So what I've shown here, this device is called as a pentode. So they introduced another terminal in between the anode, the output terminal, and the control gate terminal. And again, they introduced one more terminal as well. This device is called pentode to solve this problem. But this device came with its own additional problems. It came with a problem of higher increased noise. Okay. So now it was a problematic solution, but still it was a good solution. They just introduced one more terminal in between so that it acted like a shield between these two. So there was no direct contact between the anode and the grid. So they introduced one metal plate in between, and that somehow fixed that issue, but introduced a new problem of noise. So that is when in 1930s, this was in 1920s, pentode was developed in 1920s. What engineers did at that time, conventionally, always engineers would connect the anode terminal, which is like your drain terminal in a vacuum tube amplifier. This is cathode, was normally connected to the grid of the next stage. If you want high gain, they'll connect it to the grid of the next stage. But the problem here is not high gain, but a high gain for higher frequencies. We wanted the amplifier to amplify really a large frequency signal, high frequency signal. So then what they did was, instead of connecting the anode to a grid, instead they connected anode to the cathode. So they cascaded an anode and a cathode. And this configuration, interestingly, helped solve this problem of capacitance multiplication. I'll show how it reduces that problem. Okay, we'll see that. And I think one of you are asking the question that, why does charging time matter? I told you, right? Eventually, if you had no capacitors, if there was no capacitor, if you applied a sine wave at the input, instantaneously you will see a sine wave at the output. But now, if because of a capacitance, the capacitance takes some time to charge. So let's assume you are applying a sine wave for this RC circuit at the input. The capacitor, instantaneously it won't, I mean, you won't get an output exactly as a sine wave at the output here. But rather, it will take some time to charge. It has a time constant. It will slowly charge, but by the time it is about to charge, the input has already reversed its polarity. So now it will start discharging. It doesn't really get time to discharge as well. So therefore, it will look like an attenuated or a reduced amplitude sine wave at the output. So that's why charging time matters. So if the charging time is really large, your system is slow. If your system is slow, you will not be able to amplify high frequency signals. So high frequency means very fast varying signals. Okay, so yeah, so I'll come back to this. I said that there is this problem of capacitance getting multiplied by a huge factor, because of which the input sees a really large capacitance at the input. So therefore, it's going to think that it's a large capacitance, so therefore it will take a really large time to charge this node. And that, whenever time constant is large, I told you guys to keep in mind, if your time constant is large, because capacitance is large, it means your system is slow, which means it won't be able to amplify high frequency signals. High frequency means fast signals. If you want to amplify fast signals which are varying very fast, then you need very high frequency, high bandwidth, low time constant amplifiers. Time constant should be as less as possible. No, I'm just introducing that problem. Yes. So one of you had asked a question, which is right. If you are saying that I'm going to apply a high frequency sine wave, it's never going to reach minus GMRL. Yeah, that's the problem. It's not going to reach minus GMRL. It will be much smaller than GMRL VI. But to show you the problem, I'm first applying a small sine wave of a very low frequency, a sine wave of really low frequency, and then tell you what's actually happening in the system. Okay, when you apply a low frequency, it's actually taking up a lot of charge, a lot of time to charge. But when you apply high frequency, suddenly you will see an attenuated amplitude, and that happens because of this. So we're giving an explanation. Yeah. Okay. So now I said that engineers connected an anode to terminal to the cathode terminal, and this new combination of connecting the anode to the cathode of the next stage with grid being grounded, they called it as the cascode amplifier. It's a cascade of an anode and a cathode to distinguish it from a cascade of common cathode and common collector. It was called cascode. In fact, I picked this definition from Wikipedia. I think I couldn't find the source that they were referring to, but the line, if you see here, it was a replacement. I'm not sure if you can see the text here, as a replacement for pentode. And so the name may be as an abbreviation of a cascaded triode amplifier. Cascaded triode is nothing but your vacuum tube amplifier. This one is a triode amplifier. There's three terminals, having characteristics similar to, but less noisy than a single pentode. supposedly it's in an article written in 1955, but I couldn't find the source, so I directly quoted Wikipedia's quote. Okay, so the name cascode comes from that. It's a cascade of an anode and a cathode. It gives you all the benefits of pentode, but without that increased noise. I said there is a problem of noise with pentode, and that's why it avoided it, and it became popular after that. Now I'll try to mathematically show using a MOSFET, how is it beneficial, so you'll be able to appreciate it better. From a MOS technology, I told you grid is like gate, and this is like common source. Source is like cathode. So your drain terminal should be connected to the source terminal. So you're cascading. What configuration is this? The first stage, what configuration is the first stage? In a MOS device, it is a common source configuration. The second stage, it is what configuration is the second stage? A common gate configuration. So this cascade of common source, common gate configuration is what we call as cascode. And the name cascode comes from vacuum tube amplifiers, because it was invented as an idea when vacuum tube amplifiers were being perfected. In 1930s was when this name was given to it. Now I'll show you how do you get that advantage. All I need to show you is that input previously was providing a charge given by 1 plus GmRL times Vi into C, where C was the capacitance between gate and drain. It was providing a really large charge, and it was thinking that it was as though it was providing a charge to a capacitance of value 1 plus GmRL. It was seeing a really large capacitance. That was the problem previously. Now if I show that the capacitance seen at the input is much smaller than this, then we know that this topology works. So first, here if you see, let's ignore R0 for the time being. If I ignore R0 for the time being, in this circuit, look at the circuit here. If I ignore R0 for the time being, let's assume this node voltage is Vi. What will be the gain of the stage? What is the looking in impedance into the source? You're looking into the source. So what is the looking in impedance? You're looking into the source. R0 is infinity. So you're connected some finite load resistance, 1 by Gm. The source resistance is 1 by Gm. So you have the first stage. I'll draw the first stage here. The first stage has a common source amplifier and a resistance, loading resistance of value 1 by Gm. So what is the voltage gain in the first stage from input to output? Gm, I'm assuming Gm of the second stage is also same. So what is the voltage gain? Minus 1, right? Your V0 1 will be equal to minus Vi. It's minus 1. So the node voltage here is going to be minus Vi. So now can you tell me what is the total voltage across the capacitor? On one terminal it is Vi, on the other terminal it is minus Vi. So what is the total voltage across the capacitor? 2 Vi, right? It is 2 Vi. So the total charge the input has to deliver to the capacitor is 2C into Vi. So now previously the capacitance, the input voltage, the input source was delivering a charge of 1 plus G. If let's say your gain is 1000, let's assume GmRL is 1000, it was supplying a charge of 1001 times C into Vi. So it was seeing, or rather I can say, it was perceiving an input capacitance. It was thinking that it was supplying this charge to a really large capacitance of value 1001 times C. Here I'm assuming GmRL is 1000. It looked like a really large capacitance. But now look at it. At the input, it's going to look like a capacitance of value 2C. The input capacitance, or the perceived effective capacitance at the input, will be just 2C. It has reduced significantly by several orders of magnitude. So therefore, small capacitance means small time constant. If your time constant is small, then your system is fast, which means if your system is fast, amplifier is fast, it will be able to amplify high frequency signals. So this is the cascode configuration, and the thought process behind that, I told you how the thought process came about. By introducing a common drain as a common source and a common gate amplifier combination, I could reduce the effective capacitance seen at the input. And it worked very well in situations where your source resistance happened to be really large. If your source resistance is really large, then the time constant will happen to be very large if you had Miller effect. And that problem could be resolved using a cascode amplifier. Okay, so that's what I've shown here. This is a cascode amplifier. This is a common source amplifier. Now, I didn't discuss the DC gain of this amplifier. Right now, ignore R0. R0 is infinity. What is the DC gain of this amplifier, of this MOS amplifier? At DC, assume capacitance is open. What is the DC gain? This node voltage will be at VI. This node gate voltage will be at VI. So what is the DC gain at the output? Minus of GM RL times VI. That's your DC or low frequency gain of this amplifier. Can you tell me what will be the DC gain of the cascode amplifier? What will be the DC gain of this amplifier here? So whenever I say DC gain, just open circuit the capacitance. Open circuit the capacitance. You apply VI, what the gate current drawn is zero. Gate current is zero. So this gate voltage will also be at VI. So what is the current flowing through the first MOS device? It will be GMVI. R0 is infinity. So what is the current at the output terminal here? What is this current? GMVI, right? That is also GMVI because it's a common gate configuration. That is also GMVI. So what is the voltage gain in case of a cascode amplifier? So the voltage gain is minus GMRL. It is exactly the same as a common source amplifier. So now look at this. The voltage gain is exactly the same, but then at the input, you are seeing a much smaller capacitance multiplication effect. That's the advantage of cascode amplifier. Okay, so this is how cascode amplifiers became popular. They are used in applications with very high bandwidth. They offer you very high bandwidth. And there is another advantage called as input to output isolation. I'll talk about this in the next lecture. I'll just briefly discuss this and show the cascode configuration. So here you see in this figure here, this is a cascade of a common cathode and common cathode amplifiers. So this is a general way, but this still doesn't. Does this solve the problem of the multiplied capacitance? If I use a common source and common source, will it solve the problem of multiplied capacitance? See, this is the capacitance here. If this node voltage is VI, let's assume this has some intrinsic gain. What will be the voltage at this point? Minus GM R0 times VI. So it doesn't solve because this capacitance has still to be charged to a really large voltage. So it doesn't solve it. So this configuration, even though it gives you high gain, will not be a useful structure for bandwidth, increasing the bandwidth. So therefore, I've shown the cascode structure in three devices. The first one here is vacuum tube amplifiers. I've shown a cascode amplifier structure and using vacuum tube amplifiers. Using BJTs, it's a cascade of a common emitter configuration and a common base configuration. If you cascade common emitter, common base, so this is cascode using BJTs and this is cascode using MOSFETs. In all the three amplifiers, the gain is just minus GMRL. The gain is the same, but what you save is the what you get as an advantage is a reduced input capacitance. Input capacitance is reduced in cascode amplifiers. We will revisit this in a much more rigorous manner when we talk about the frequency response of cascode amplifiers. But right now, to introduce you to the idea of cascode amplifiers and how did the engineers at that time solve this problem of multiplied capacitance by choosing a cascode configuration. Okay, so that's why I just wanted to introduce that. So here shown is a cascode configuration using all the three devices. The idea of cascode originated in 1920s, 30s is when the paper was published, where the name cascode was introduced. But if you see, even though the devices changed, we went from BJTs to MOSFETs, the idea of cascoding remained. Okay, to the same principle holds here. The capacitance is reduced even in BJTs and even in MOS devices. Okay, so we'll talk about this in more detail in the next lecture. So I'll stop at this point.